Judge, let's try to answer some of Senator Harris's accusations. Are you a racist?
I am not a racist, Senator Kennedy.
You're sure?
I'm positive.
Do you support, in all cases, corporations over working people?
I do not, and I think if you look at my record, you will see cases in which I've decided in favor of plaintiffs, not corporations.
Are you against clean air, bright water, and environmental justice?
I am not against any of those things. Those are policies that the Congress has pursued in many statutes, and I think we all reap the benefits of when those statutes work.
Do you support science?
I do, and I help my children with their homework when they're trying to learn it.
You're sure of that?
I am sure I believe in science, and I support science.
Do you support children and prosperity?
I support children, seven of my own, and then support others, you know, obviously think children are our future, support children, and yes, I support prosperity.
Do you hate little warm puppies?
I do not hate little warm puppies.
Okay, I just want to get all that clear. See, we did that in about 2 minutes.
I think that my daughter, Juliet, who's 10, would want me to put in a plug right now to say I do not hate chinchillas because we don't have a puppy in the Barrett house, but we do have a very fluffy chinchilla, and so I don't hate chinchillas either.
Duly noted. Look, Senator Harris is my friend, and I get it. She's running for vice president, but I want to address these voting rights allegations. Senator Harris has implied that some states are pristine and other states aren't in terms of discriminating against people on the basis of gender or race or ethnicity. We disagree. She thinks America is systemically racist. I don't. I think our history is the best evidence of that. I don't think we're a racist country. I think we're a country that has some racists in it. You know, I'm very proud of the fact that our country has gone from, in 150 years, which in the grand scheme of life, death, and the resurrection is the blink of an eye, we've gone from institutionalized slavery to an African-American president. We've passed, I'll miss some of these dates, but we've passed civil rights laws in, I think, 1869, 1871, 1957, 1961, 1965, 1990, 1991. I'm pretty proud of that. But let me get back to my point. My good friend, Senator Harrison, she is my friend. I have an enormous amount of respect for Kamala. She suggested that some states are wicked and other states are pristine. And I would gently remind her that California, a state I love, I love visiting California. You got to keep moving because they'll tax you if you stand still. But I love California. But California has a deep history of discrimination against Asian Americans. California has a deep history of discrimination against Hispanics. And I'm not saying they're true, if this is true, but there have been serious allegations made against Senator Harris that as Attorney General of the wonderful state of California, that she participated in racial disparities in prosecution. Now let me jump subjects again. We've talked about precedent and stare decisis and why it's important. Mm-hmm. We need to have stability. Mm-hmm. People need to be able to rely on the law. Mm-hmm. But you're not suggesting that the United States Supreme Court never has, nor should it ever, reverse precedent if they think they got it wrong, are you?
No, the Supreme Court has always acknowledged that there are circumstances in which it must be able to reverse precedent.
And you mentioned reliance interests. How many Americans have relied on a particular decision by the United States Supreme Court as a factor in deciding whether to overturn that precedent?
Yes.
Reliance interests are not dispositive, are they?
Reliance interests are not dispositive. For example, in Brown versus the Board of Education, I mean, clearly the South had an entire system of segregated schooling
built
up, and so they had relied on Plessy versus Ferguson, but reliance interests were not dispositive there. Because you do.
There were a lot of reliance interests on Plessy v. Ferguson, weren't there?
There were. So I think Brown illustrates that reliance interests are not dispositive. You have to look at all the factors in the stare decisis test.
Okay. Yesterday, another friend, Senator Booker, Rhodes Scholar, hell of a tight end, too, Stanford. He asked you if you, I wrote it down, empathize with people struggling to pay for health care. And of course, you appropriately said yes. I mean, we all do. Under our Madisonian system of separation of powers and checks and balances, which branch of government is supposed to address the struggle that many Americans have to afford health care? Congress or the United States Supreme Court?
Congress, Senator Kennedy.
Let's talk just a second about state constitutions. I know you know this, but we forget sometimes that state constitutions preceded our federal constitution. Am I right? Mm-hmm. And in fact, there are parts of our federal constitution that were copied from state constitutions. Mm-hmm. Having said that, there are a lot of provisions that are similar. For example, we know we have a Fourth Amendment in the federal constitution. Many states have their own version of the Fourth Amendment.
Yes.
What happens when a state Supreme Court construes its Fourth Amendment differently than the United States Supreme Court construes the federal Fourth Amendment?
So the state is free to construe its Fourth Amendment differently as a matter of state law, but of course the federal constitution also applies to the states through the supremacy clause, so a state isn't free to violate the Fourth Amendment. But one thing states often do, which I'm sure you know because, you know, of your interest in state constitutions, and we talked about the Louisiana Constitution yesterday, is that many states interpret their versions of the Fourth Amendment or other provisions to be even more protective of rights than is the United States Constitution.
So the federal Constitution sets a floor.
But not a ceiling.
So if Louisiana wants to construe its Fourth Amendment as not having any exceptions to the warrant requirement, we could do that.
States are free. They're free to fashion their policies as they want within the limits of the federal constitution. And so the contours of the federal Fourth Amendment would not themselves prohibit Louisiana from doing that.
Yeah, why does that make sense to you?
Well, that's federalism. So my friend Judge Jeff Sutton on the Sixth Circuit has written a book called 51 Imperfect Solutions. And his point is that, you know, we have all these laboratories of democracy, as they're called, the states, and it's federalism. Different states have different preferences. Their electorates can make different decisions in Louisiana than in Indiana than in California. And so if some states want to have greater protections, and many do, we allow those differences to flourish within the limits of the common denominator that we have, which is mm-hmm. the United States Constitution.
Mm-hmm. And that's just respect for the states.
That is.
Okay. The federal Constitution has a state action requirement. Am I right?
It does.
Okay. Would a state be free to not have a state action requirement?
I am not aware of any principle that would prevent a state from, in a statute or a constitutional provision, I mean, states can be the master of their own constitutions, right?
And what do I mean when I'm talking about state action?
State action requirement. So the only constitutional provision, I think, in our Constitution that applies directly to individuals is the 13th Amendment, which prohibits slavery. The 14th Amendment, which is the context in which the state action requirement has been explored in Supreme Court case law in the civil rights cases, means that the equal protection guarantee or even all the Bill of Rights that are incorporated through it, like the First Amendment, only apply to the government. So when I'm teaching this to my con law students, what I tell them is that I can tell my kids at the dinner table, the First Amendment doesn't apply here. Because they'll often say, like, hey, what about my freedom of speech? And I'll say, you don't have any, because in my house it is the law of Amy. So, but public universities, you know, are different than private universities in that regard, because the First Amendment applies to government-run institutions, but not to private universities.
Yeah. I don't know what the law is right now, but I think there was a case, maybe it's been overruled, but the California Supreme Court, based on its its constitutional history, has ruled that the First Amendment in the California Constitution, or the First Amendment version, has no state action requirement. It doesn't just protect you against government, it protects you against everybody. It's just crazy.
I didn't know that.
Yeah, some interesting litigation. I read somewhere that you are an admirer of Kate Chopin.
Oh, yeah.
Who is? Tell us who she was and why you admire her.
Well, when I was in college, back in my English major days.
She's Louisiana.
That is, yeah. That's right. And she wrote a book focused on Louisiana and a woman who comes to Louisiana from, now I can't remember what part of the South she was from, and talked about her in becoming accustomed to New Orleans and its particular culture.
Mm-hmm.
And I very much appreciated that because, you know, it, especially, you know, as a New Orleanian, I thought it was an insightful look into what the history of New Orleans is like. And my family, you know, my great-great-grandparents came to New Orleans from France, and my family's been in New Orleans for generations, and so its history is important to me.
Ms. Chopin had a very feminist point of view, too, did she not?
She did. So the awakening.
Sort of before her time, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. She did.
Two more. Tell me what the legal authority is, if you know, for a universal injunction. We got about 600 federal judges, federal district court judges. I could be off by a few. And they not only have limited jurisdiction, but they have limited venue, if you will. They hear cases in a certain geographical area. How can one federal district court judge in a limited venue enjoin a congressional statute or a presidential executive order for the entire United States, continental and otherwise?
Well, that is a disputed issue of law that's in litigation, and the court it's been on the court's docket, the authority of district courts to issue nationwide injunctions. So that would, you know, take me down the path of opining on a case that, you know, could wind up in litigation in front of me.
Okay. I got one last question.
Hope it's an easy one.
It is. It's a sincere question. I'm generally curious. Who does the laundry in your house?
We increasingly have been trying to get our children to take responsibility for their own, but those efforts are not always successful. So we run a lot of loads of laundry.
Well, you're very impressive, Judge.
Thank you, Senator.